fair, it would be sweet, nice. Pleasant. Come on, you know what I mean? Like,
Leonid prepared enough questions to himself. So the last talk of the conference will be by Leonid Gurvits. He's talking about hyperbolic polynomials and all that jazz.
Exactly. So essentially, we'll talk about, it's kind of a journey. So the first paper, which kind of initiated this operator scaling application to this checking on singularity for certain cases, was in 2002. I think it was January. And it had, that paper already had everything. It had scaling, it had application to the trunk one case. And people thought for a while that most important thing which was in that paper was actually proof of hardness of entanglement. So it was also in that paper. Okay, and also it mentioned the problem about the ball, that largest separable ball, which was more elaborated in that conference version. Okay, but it started all in New Jersey. Here I was working at NSC Research Corporation, which was okay, and it was like. And it was kind of semi-industrial place. And I was in the group which was deep learning. And at that time, the hottest learning topic was boosting. And boosting was a multiplicative method that everybody talks boosting, boosting, boosting. I decided to understand it. And I remember that long time ago, a friend of mine told me about the Sinkhorn scaling. Oh, it's also like iterative method, okay? And also, actually, surprisingly, is related to this IDEA Institute, which is also in the vicinities. Okay, and it's actually when I was thinking about this. Boosting and Sinkhorn, and I learned about this Kullberg-Leibniz divergence. I will be more technical about Bregman distances. A friend of mine asked me this question. So you given a band matrix, absolutely applied question. You given a band matrix such that each block here is positive semi-definite. Each minor you can insert, okay? So you would like to complete it, it's a completion problem. And moreover, you would like to maximize entropy by that thing, okay? And the reason what he wanted to do this question was purely applied. It was for face recognition. It was to construct better kind of Mahalanobis distance. Anyway, so it was absolutely applied question. And I already knew connections between Sinkhorn scaling and maximal entropy, okay? But anyway, so who knows how to solve this problem? Just to prove that it exists, that it's certainly necessary condition for completion. Such that this matrix is positive semi-definite. So necessary condition that all those blocks, okay? And you can complete it, okay? And the thing is, you actually can view this problem as in a probabilistic way. So what you so here you given marginals on variables. This will be the size of the band. So you given marginals. So we already heard about this problem in Michael talk, but in quantum version, and they compatible. So if you have this marginal x1. XR, and the next one So common things, they have the same distribution because they come from the thing. Okay. So now you get this question. So you're given compatible marginals, and with let's say their densities, which are Gaussians here. Can you put them together, this kind of classical marginal problem, in order to? And you know, if you play a little bit, so you can actually do like this. So if the size, you can actually group variables such that it will be just those will be into two, okay? And there is the solution to this problem. So again, you're given those marginals which are compatible, you would like to have maximal entropy. And the solution is extremely simple. It will be like this. And conditional distribution of x3 choose x2. Choose x2 from this, okay. And this will be maximal entropy thing. But this operation, but how I kind of, I did not know about this, how I figure out. I just applied analog of synchro scaling to this problem. So it was absolutely numerical experiment. So I started with, roughly in this case, with independent Gaussians. And I started to scale. So what I mean, I first want to assign, let's say, this guy, okay? I will divide this guy by its marginal and multiply by that given one. And I thought that I will need to iterate it, okay? So just wrote a simple code. Actually, at some point, I was writing simple codes in MATLAB. I wrote that simple code and terminated. So they decided to prove it, and it was this thing. And first of all, this is completely Gaussian operation. So when you do this, and because it's a Gaussian operation, the final result will be positive semi-definite matrix, which solves this problem. And to me it was kind of a big surprise, because I knew about this problem from my original, let's say, area control theory. I actually did not know signal processing, how they do it in that thing. So, okay, so that brought me to dealing with, so I started with my that friend who posed that problem to deal with those Gaussian iterations, this Gaussian scaling, which was again projection in Kubler-Leubner divergence. By the way, the interesting thing, why I decided to solve this problem and to be creative, etc., etc. Not because I like it so much. This again, scientists actually, they live lives. Sometimes those lives are not simple. I was practically unemployed at that time, and I did need to impress the guy, you know, that I can be helpful. Okay, and it's not a joke. And he gave me, like, he was paying for 3 days a week to do this stuff, okay? But it gave me some breathing space. And again, it's not a joke.
But what you said there was once you sample x1 to xk minus 1, you sample xk conditioned on the.
Yes, yeah. And the point is, I thought I will need to cycle because I was doing it blindly. I just did this. Again, this is analog of scaling, so you divide by margin and multiply. And in general, if you don't have this nice structure, which is a tree structure on those subsets, it's a complicated problem, it's a completion problem, you need to do semi-definite programming. But in this case, it was simple algorithm. So anyways, and that was this Kubler-Leubner divergence. And I was reading papers, and people already mentioned about transportation problem and that scaling. Who knows how it works?
Who knows what works?
The connection, how you can solve transportation problem using standard synchrometric scaling.
Transportation means bipartite flow?
Yes. And that was that actually was done by physicists, and they did, and they had completely different thinking. So here's the algorithm. So you have that matrix of weights, positive or negative, and you would like to maximize that over permutation, that sum of AI pure standard problem, which is the same, of course, as to multiply by W stochastic matrix.
That's a weighted matching problem.
Yes, yes. Okay? And it's additive, and you can have. So essentially, what they solve multiplicative. So this is what you do. You take exponents to get to non-negative case. Okay? So now you would like to take maximum for those products, okay? So you need to compute maximum of numbers, okay? So and you essentially use this formula that L infinity norm is limit when p goes to infinity of LP norm. Okay? So instead of computing how you compute sum of maximum numbers, you take them to big power, you add those guys, and you take 1 over p, okay? So here, again, I'm telling you not how it's their thinking. Their thinking was different, I will explain. So what would be the sum of those over p permanent? But I need a big number, so this power, it will be this t. So this is the good approximation for maximum of product. So good approximation would be the logarithm of permanent so this would be the good approximation, okay? We cannot compute permanent. So but what we can compute what those my friends Nati, Alex, and Tavi did, we can essentially compute what is called capacity, which is the product of scaling factors. So again, so what instead of computing this thing, I compute log of those of, and let me explain what is that. We, for any, So and this is comes to this main thing, which one of the main motivation. So if you can by some magic scale matrix as a one diagonal doubly stochastic, that another diagonal, that what is again called capacity of A, which I will define more formally, it will be product of diagonals. And this is doubly stochastic. And the permanent of A will be, this is van der Waarden, will be less or equal than capacity and greater than equal. Okay, so now what you do, so this is what you, instead of, this is what you approximate. Okay. So this is the, okay, and how you compute this capacity by scaling this matrix of big exponents, okay? So this is the algorithm, and you can get bounds using this thing, okay? So first, you know, and so it's, again, it's incredibly similar to what was in, conceptually to what was in LSW. But nobody talked about those. They even did not mention permanent in that paper, okay? Why? Because they had entropic interpretation of this capacity. Okay? So again, now let's go to the formal definitions. So I will have a matrix A. Okay? No. And I will associate with this matrix important thing, which is called product polynomial. So essentially, what do? I take A, multiply by vector x11, x1n, get this result, and take product of those guys, okay? So formal definition of capacity is this. So it's actually it's a capacity of polynomial. We take infimum of this polynomial So this is one, and there is, it's kind of a theorem which is not very hard. There is another way to express this guy, which is via Kubler-Kleobner divergence, which is would be maximum over doubly stochastic matrices. And this would be the logarithm of capacity. Okay. And again, it's not that hard to prove, okay? So how those physicists did? So they knew this interpretation. And when you plug in that thing, the logs, you don't need actually van der Waarde, and it will show up in an entropic way, okay? So and this is third thing about capacity, to second. But there is another thing about capacity, which probably somebody knew. Consider the following like semi-definite programming problem. So this is the constraint on this diagonal matrix. Okay? And what I want, I would like to take infimum of product of those two guys over those constraints. Okay? Yes, yes. Yes, yeah, yeah. Okay? So it's not immediately obvious, but this infimum will be actually equal capacity of A square. Not immediately obvious, but it's not that hard actually, okay? So here's the cool thing. This problem is not actually a nice problem the way it's written here. The constraints are nice, semi-definite constraints, but I want to minimize concave function logs, okay? And minimizing concave functions on the convex set, it's not such a nice problem. Okay, so and this is and let's say the way to solve this problem, but we are lucky that there is a convex formulation of this problem. And so here's the question: I am actually not sure if even in this simple form, for an arbitrary matrix, this problem is polynomially solvable. So I think it's NP hard. Okay. Okay, but so now not non-negative. Yes, yes, not non-negative. So for non-negative matrix, this problem can be solved because of this formula. And this formula, which has already was mentioned, is fine, we can do it because this is what.
Okay, good.
actually, the funny thing is about the video, okay? I did not think about the video. but, I usually give talks wearing a hat. And again, it was not intentional, but some person here told me that, listen, man, I'm so happy to see that you have hair. Because, you know, so now the audience can see that I actually have, that my head is not a wig. It's not a toupee, okay? So I'm still a visual person, you know, like, anyway. Okay, but again, how we solve this problem? How we solve this problem? Because we, this is how we can approximate log of capacity by doing this thing, infimum over y1 plus yn equals zero of that product polynomial, log of product polynomial, and plug in exponents. And as already mentioned, this guy is convex, okay? Of course, you need to work a little bit harder if you want to solve by ellipsoid method to do, you know. Yeah. But on the other hand, we have a beautiful algorithm for scaling, which, for instance, strongly polynomial, which was in LS. Okay, we can use that thing. There are many ways to solve this problem, okay? So, incidentally, one of the problems which I will be talking about will be this one. What about, I have this problem. I have diagonal matrix, positive semi-definite. But now Q is positive semi-definite. So D is diagonal. So this is my constraint. And I would like now to minimize okay. So it also looks like a bad problem because again concave function, but it's okay because let's say I'm using that if Q, for instance, is non-singular, that it will be like this. And this in those variables is still a convex set, and I will now maximize it, okay? And it's a standard trick in semi-definite programming, okay? So what is your guess? What this problem will be relaxation to? This one. The previous one was in some fancy way relaxation to permanent of non-negative. Ah, and here Q is a positive semi-definite. Let's make it strictly positive. This is why I can do inversion, et cetera, et cetera. And moreover, this is why I can write in minimum, because if it's positive, because those Ds will be bounded, okay? So what is your guess? So what is this? So this will be, this happened to be how you approximate with exponential factor permanent of Q, but it required its own van der Waarden inequality, which was proved recently, okay? Okay, so now Hall condition, and now I will do this dance, we'll see how it will all lead. So Hall condition. So here's the way to write Hall condition. So I take this product polynomial.
The Hall condition for the matrix.
For the standard Hall matrix condition.
But 0, 1 or in general?
General non-negative matrix. I will take product polynomial. And of course it's a sum of monomials with coefficients. So here, quite obviously, coefficient are non-negative. In general, we need to work a little bit harder to prove non-negativity. Here, and what I can do with this polynomial, I can introduce, associate with polynomial a degree function. So what I will do, I will take a subset of S. I will take subset of 1 to n of variables, okay? And my function will be degree defined by this polynomial prod of this. So what I do, I will look for the variables from that group, and I will go through all non-zero monomials in the support, and I will take maximum, okay? So it would be maximum of sum of omega i's i sign set over that monomial is positive. Okay. So this is the whole condition now in terms of these guys. Says that this degree function for that specific polynomial is greater or equal than cardinality of this set. Okay. So again, take as any subset. Okay. So this is okay. How you do it? It's just, you know, you just take a subset, let's say S, and you take variables from this guy which shows what is the highest degree, would be the largest number of non-zero vectors here, which is exactly will be that cardinality of you of union of those subsets. Okay.
Yeah, so this condition is different only if
yeah. No, but I don't even talk about this. Is just I don't talk about whole theorem. I say whole condition is this, that so whole
so
condition.
Demand on your polynomial.
So whole condition. We don't even know whether it's equivalent to permanent, but it's a natural thing. Okay, and the interesting thing is that. It's the number of those conditions exponential because yeah, that was a big deal when people figure out how to deal with them. Okay, exponential number. Okay, so this is the whole condition. So now capacity. And here is the another way to represent whole condition, which prominently shows in that operator case. You take matrix A, you apply it to vector X with non-negative coordinates, and you take rank. So what would be the rank? It would be the number of positive entries in this output. Okay, and this will be the rank here. Okay. So the number of positive output, the number of positive coordinates in the output is greater or equal to the number of positive coordinates in input. This is okay. So and here is how you can quantively. So this was purely combinatorial statement, integer numbers. So this is how you can quantify it. Order vector X. Okay, and order vector y. And it says that i-th largest guy, so this is how you can quantify it. There exists constant ci such that I largest guy of output is greater than equal some constants which depends on i largest guy. Okay. How you prove it? So essentially, if you have here I guys, okay, that you're supposed to have here at least I guys. So this constant kind of will be, and you can get it from the matrix. But again, it's a simple exercise that this is quantitative version of this statement, okay. And from this quantitative version, you get, and those C's are positive numbers, okay. And if matrix was 0 and 1, actually those C's will be greater or equal than 1. Okay? And from this thing, you get bound on capacity. So capacity of this matrix A will be greater or equal than product of CIs. Okay? So essentially, what I wanted to tell you that this thing, just without any permanence, this thing implies that capacity is positive. And moreover, in integer case, it implies that capacity actually is greater than equal than 1. Okay. The big thing is that can we prove in this case inverse stuff? Okay. Without having yes, we will do it by scaling. Okay. So we will scale that thing. Capacity will jump, and again, it's easy to prove that capacity is bounded. So anyway, so without proving whole theorem, we actually can using scaling, we can have algorithm which can deal with this exponential number of guys. Okay. Yes, but let us look. Let us look more closely at this question. So what does it mean? We already had it. What does it mean capacity is positive? So I have this some specific polynomial with no negative coefficients. I divide it by this thing. And I take infimum over positive guys. And this happened to be positive. And we already had this, and which is simple stuff. It's that Hahn-Banach theorem. Polynomial has no negative coefficient. That this statement is equivalent that this monomial is in the convex hull of Newton polytope. That this vector 1, 1, 1 is in the convex hull of Newton polytope, okay? And it's kind of easy, okay? Kind of easy. So essentially, without any combinatorics, we get that this vector 1, 1, 1. So what combinatoric does to us? It actually proves that it's not only in Newton polytope, it actually belongs to support. So that whole theorem, it says that this guy is in the support of our polynomial. Why? Because of this connection to permanent. Yes. Because of this beautiful and simple connection to the permanent. So permanent is a mixed term of this product polynomial. This is actually a reason for Reiser formula, by the way. So Reiser formula has nothing to do with permanent, okay? Reiser formula is, you can view Reiser formula as the formula to get a polynomial as a black box and to exactly partially differentiate it, okay? And of course there is, but I will get to that, okay? So anyway, so permanent is a coefficient of monomial x1 xn. So this coefficient, okay. So essentially whole theorem for specific polynomial proves that if this guy, okay. So first of all, the scaling proves it, this statement. So why we already proved whole theorem? Okay, because we can prove for free without whole theorem the doubly stochastic matrix has a permutation inside. By proving that extreme points of that directly, that extreme points of the convex set of doubly stochastic matrix, they are permutations. So again, that if that connection which we had. That this thing implies that capacity positive will prove to us that this scaling will converge. It will converge to something, to doubly stochastic with support inside of us. And it will be the, so it proves, we do, so this is how we can prove. But in general, of course, it would be much, much harder, okay? So now, and now it's all this stuff. And now what the another thing? So again, so now what we, so what we prove, so what we prove that capacity of A is positive implies permanent is positive. So this is whole theorem. But now again, we need a quantitative statement. So we want to have a bound. And the upper bound is obvious. Okay? And this is, of course, van der Waaden thing, okay? So we can do this as m factorial divided m. So anyway, so this was the status of things of around LSW paper. But at that time, there was a Barvinov paper. It was a Barvinov, which actually dealt, which gave randomized, but polynomial time algorithm for simple exponential approximation of thing is called mixed discriminant. Okay? So what is now mixed discriminant? It's not such a again, my polynomial will be determinant polynomial. And those matrices are positive semi-definite. So it's like frames which we had, okay? And mixed discriminant is coefficient of this polynomial which corresponds to monomial x1, x2, x3. Again, I have this polynomial. I can define capacity. I can also do this degree set and all that jazz. Okay, and if I will define degree set and will try to see what is Hall theorem, Hall condition will be Rado conditions. So now for this polynomial, degree of the set will be rank of those matrices and again it's not hard thing if you just will do so okay so the whole condition will be that generalized whole condition for this thing would be and that already getting closer to what to rank non-decreasing, okay? And again, we can define capacity for this thing. And again, it would be quite easy to prove again by ordering and doing some standard minimax things for eigenvalues that capacity will be of this so this condition will imply that capacity of this determinant polynomial is positive. So question is, can we do scaling here? So and what is the scaling here? And do we have a quantitative bound again? So maybe we will be able to compute this logarithm of capacity pretty much which by something. And can we do again? And but most importantly, is there a bound? So, and this was the conjecture, which is, I did not know at that time, but it was stated 10 years prior. The conjecture was like this. For this polynomial, is it true that this mixed discriminant, which is again mixed term, the coefficients of that product x1, xn, is it greater than equal than n factorial divided n to the No, but there is no, but instead of W stochasticity will be capacity. Capacity captures W stochasticity. Okay, and an LSW paper, they had the luxury, they had van der Waarden conjecture. So we did not have van der Waarden when we started to work with Alex on this problem. We did not have van der Waarden conjecture. Bapat conjecture, yes, okay. So we started to think about this problem right in 98. Bapat conjecture was, I think, 88 or 89. So anyway, so it was the time. Bapat actually, he's our age guy. So he was well aware about proof of van der Waarden conjecture. He knew, like, he was like the main expert for that class. And he wrote exposition papers about the proof. And, you know, he did not know how to prove it. So, and again, it was not that simple. Okay. And again, I am practically unemployed. Okay, and things don't work for me. And I realized that, you know, again, it's life. Science is life. And I realized that I really need some hit result. Otherwise, okay, I have no work, and actually my family is collapsing. This is the situation, okay? And no ideas, hard problem, okay? So I think interesting situation. Do you need to work on hard problem when you're in this tight spot, okay? So you're already in a tight spot, okay? You work on hard problems. Okay, so gamble, okay? And lucky enough, I got some like semi-sabbatical at Technion. And I had about like 8 months of quiet life. And I went there, and I did not solve it there, but then after I came back to... So anyway, so, and this thing was proved, okay? Before. Okay. So, but now, why Barvinak, what was Barvinak interest to this thing? Barvinak interest to the thing was very noble and very applied. Was very algebraic, geometry interest, okay? So what is the most important algebraic computational tool, algebraic geometry, which use worst mixed? Who knows? Mixed volume. Mixed volume, because it's the number, it counts the number of isolated solutions. And again, it's the crucial. So it's so crucial that I remember once I was giving a talk, and there were guys who were asking questions about that thing from Wall Street. And why Wall Street, people who work for Wall Street, would be interested in mixed volume? What is your guess? Okay? So, and the reason is because of game theory. So there is this kind of games, polynomial games, when the number of Nash equilibria is the number of solutions of system of polynomial equations. Okay, so they needed that. Okay, and. So, by the way, these days you have to be careful when you say, oh, I have an algorithm, say, for something, okay, efficient algorithm. No, really, you should be careful. So, if you know, so you say that, say, I have an algorithm for factoring, okay, don't, okay, and again, if you're not a random guy, don't make those jokes. If you're a random guy, they say you're crazy, okay? If you're not a random guy, don't make those jokes, really.
Leonid is all recorded.
Listen, my friend, we are not in St. Petersburg. We're in Princeton, United States of America, and it's still a very free country, okay? So don't worry about, okay? Don't worry about, okay? So I... And I love all this country, so everything will be cool. Okay. So, and actually it was related to this mixed volume. Mixed volume is also polynomial, related to polynomial. The polynomial is one of the most beautiful invention of Minkowski. So the polynomial will be volume polynomial. And you take volume so, and here Ki is a compact convex set, and this is Minkowski sum. And you first define it on non-negative axis, and he proved that it's polynomial. After that, you extend, okay? And mixed volume is, again, coefficient of this polynomial which corresponds to x1. Mm-hmm. And you want, and what you want to do and say those guys are given like that weak membership oracles, the standard stuff in that computational geometry. And you would like to do the same thing for those guys people did in that marvelous application of Markov chain for single convex set, meaning to compute volume. To have, let's say, this algorithm. Okay? What Barvinek paper did.
It's not clear from what you wrote that you want to approximate the volume arbitrarily well.
Yes. It's not okay. So what I want to do? What is my goal? So mixed volume is that coefficient of this polynomial. In general, what is my goal for this approximate counting? So I want to have some computable thing k such that this will be greater than equal and less than, let's say, some constant desire. So again, what currently we can do? We can do something like this. Okay. Moreover, only using randomized algorithms, which is, by the way, this is impossible using deterministic algorithms in Oracle setting, because there is a two. Okay. And what Barvinek did? So he actually did use those mixed discriminants to approximate this mixed volume. We factor roughly like this. And essentially, the idea was it was a complicated paper. You approximate those convex sets by ellipsoids in out, and mixed volumes of ellipsoids are approximated by mixed discriminants of some positive semidefinite. Okay. So and again, the challenge was, can I do again like for permanent, e to the or some constant, just some constant to the power n. Okay. And that looked absolutely hopeless problem. And moreover, how would and now for this, for all those, for determinantal polynomial, determinantal polynomial is a tuple of matrices, defined by tuple of matrices. And for our matrix, there was a natural condition of double stochasticity. So here the condition of double stochasticity is traces of those matrices are equal to one. And some of them is identity. It's exactly like there was the talk about when non-uniform case were like those guys were constants, this was the identity, okay, in the frame, okay? And for matrix, of course, it's the standard double stochasticity. So what would be the analog of double stochasticity for volume, for this volume situation? So what tuple of convex sets supposed to be called double stochastic? Any suggestions?
For one, it should be the ball.
Huh? Oh, you can have many like natural things, but no, you know, okay, so what would be your guess? What would be? And again, computationally useful. We need a definition which is computationally useful, which will allow some kind of scaling, you know, which is again computationally doable scaling. What? Yeah.
For each QI,
yeah.
It's the same as saying that the derivative of log
that. Yeah. Here's the notion of double stochasticity, which happened to be very useful, okay? The notion of the. Now I have a polynomial in n variables. no negative coefficient. And here is the abstract notion of doubly stochasticity of a polynomial. So I take partial derivative at vector 1, 1, 1, and they're supposed to be all equal to 1. Okay. So this is the. Identically, yes. So again, gradient at vector 1, 1, 1 is equal vector of 1, 1, 1. Okay? So this, and this happened to be how you can deal with those guys. And I will, So by the way, if you will look at that paper about the original proof of van der Weyden, you know that there is a controversy about that proof. Okay? And I actually know those two people involved. So one is Igorichev, another is Feligman. And Feligman is actually a very interesting person. He was a classmate. It's a lot of history there. He was a classmate of Nemirovsky, Arkady Nemirovsky, okay? So again, those guys, they belong to a generation of brilliant Soviet scientists who were Jewish and who were admitted to Moscow State University. The next generation, there were very few of them. So in their group, okay, and then that generation produced a lot of absolutely great scientists, okay? So the point is that Igorichev here claimed that he used that Alexander Frankel inequality, and he promised in that paper, we will have a proof of van der Weyden for mixed volume, which was not clear what he wants to prove, and of course nothing will show up, okay? So we already know what is that doubly stochastic polynomial. What would be the generalization of Sinhor scaling in a purely polynomial setting? Okay. No matrices, nothing. I just want to do, okay. And this is the generalization. And this is like very kind of applied machine learning or whatever stuff, okay. So I start with polynomial in n variables. No negative coefficients. N variables. You can do it much more general, okay? And this is I start with vector x1, xn, such that product of them is equal 1. Okay. And I compute gradient of this polynomial. So I compute those numbers. Xi dp dxi. Essentially, I compute derivatives of and I divide by p. Essentially, I compute derivatives of a log after I apply. So this will be those numbers d1 dn. And this is the Sinhorn scaling. So again, I take my variables, I divide by those kind of exponential derivatives. But I want to keep product equal 1, so I multiply by this constant factor, okay? And if you will go to the product polynomial, our beautiful thing, geometric arithmetic means inequality, so this will be my transformation, let's call it G. That the beauty is that it will go down. Moreover,
I cannot read. What is the
written x1? Yeah, so what I do this again, this is the transformation. I take variables, which are product equal 1.
Yes, and on the right.
Yes, on the right hand side, and I compute partial derivatives, multiply by x's, and divide by p,
right.
Okay? And this will be the numbers, d1, dn, okay? Yeah, kind of gradient, okay? Yes. And now I divide each variable by this number and multiply by some constant to keep product equal one. So this division is roughly will be this it will be row in columns together in one shot. Okay? So row, and essentially it will be this is what will be for our. And those guys by Euler's identity, they add one. So the product is, and you can prove many things, okay? So the question is, will it work for, and you will hope that if you will iterate the thing, it will converge to doubly stochastic with some proper condition.
Doubly stochastic in this sense.
Yes, in that sense, okay. So now question is it true that it's always works? So what was that magical property? By the way, this is not true in general. This is not true. But what made it work for that? And in that matter, for operator scaling, okay, so what made it work? So actually, what made it work was a concavity. So here's the theorem. This thing will... Yes. So, and this little observation that it's if p to the power of 1 over n is concave on positive Wharton, then fine. The thing works, okay? Mm-hmm. In general, it's not true. But is there the general large step gradient method which works for any polynomial with a negative coefficient? By the way, somebody thought about this problem here? Okay, are they like apply? Okay, so here is the fundamental and absolutely trivial inequality for general polynomial with a negative coefficient. Yeah. So I would like to have a natural map, okay, that's a multiplicative kind of scaling, such that if I will map, if I start with vector with positive coordinates, I map that the value of polynomial will go down. I don't say it will be like this, but simply computable, like first order oracle, okay, also using, okay. And it's actually possible, okay? And the algorithm which we'll get is not much worse. And this is probably you can use for kind of general Newton polytope. Here is the fundamental inequality, absolutely trivial, which is true for any polynomial with no negative coefficients. Let's make zetas. Okay? So what I do, I take product. Again, I take those derivatives of log. Okay, and again, the number of them, the sum of them will be degree of polynomial. So with degree, it's fine. So this is one inequality. And there is second inequality. A polynomial of degree m. Yes.
Homogeneous.
Yes. Homogeneous. Actually, what I'm saying, it's true, even true in Nohom, but let's have homogeneous, okay? And those DIs are those numbers. Okay? So lower bound is this product with powers, and upper bound is moment bound, like end moment, okay? So this is true for any polynomial with the negative coefficients. And when Rafael was giving a talk about that alternative algorithm, so what was the idea of alternative algorithms? You instead of minimizing something complicated, you reduce it. Okay. But there are other ways to do to simplify those optimization problems. So for instance, if you want to minimize problem, you get a lower bound, which is efficiently computable. This one. Upper bound. And you now minimize this upper bound for a fixed x over z such that product of them is equal to 1. And the algorithm will be, so the algorithm will be like this. So you divide not by DIs, but by the root of m of DIs. The m is the degree of polynomial. And this will guarantee you, but the progress will be not this one, by this one. Okay. So instead of 1 over n improvement, would be 1 over n square improvement. It's still okay. Okay. But how come it works? But how come it works for that concave case? Because in the concave case, this was end moment inequality. There is one moment inequality. In a concave case, will be less or equal than so this is like end moment of this variable, and this is end moment of the first moment, okay? So and how we get the standards that sync or scaling, we minimize this thing, and that of course will give you okay. So you need concavity, okay? And now concavity will start to play the role, okay? So anyway, this inequality is just convexity of log. This is just convexity of log, okay? So interestingly enough, why I kind of start think about this stuff? Again, this institute, that IDEA Institute, which is nearby, they are famous for many things, but they are famous for one technology which they introduced. And the technology is that hidden Markov models which people use for speech recognition, okay? Which is very useful stuff. So what is hidden Markov models from optimizational point of view? And they have this algorithm which is called Baum-Welsch algorithm, okay? And what is that thing from that it's the following problem. So you're given a polynomial, let's say I will give you the simplest version. You're given polynomial in non-negative variables, okay? And non-negative coefficients, and you want to maximize it over simplex. So actually, in that case of hidden Markov models, it will be many simplices. The variables will be broken into groups. So it will be like condition. You need to maximize. You will divide variables into group and each. Okay. And you all know that it's an NP-hard problem. Maximizing quadratic form over simplex. You know, it's max click. Okay. And that was happening at the same time when complexity theory. So, but they did need algorithm to this problem, okay? And the algorithm, something was already discussed here. And here was the algorithm. So essentially, how you can get algorithm? You would like to maximize. Get this lower bound. And instead of maximizing, you need that large step gradient thing, movement. Instead of you start with this thing, initial distribution. How you move the next one? You maximize this thing. And it's, and this will, of course, gives you like entropic things, Kubler-Klebner. And the algorithm is like this. This new guy would be old guy times partial derivative and normalize to make sum, okay? And because coefficients are non-negative, it will keep non-negativity. This is why that exponents are good, okay? It will keep non-negativity and it will keep improving, okay? Of course, it can get stuck in the local extrema, okay? But interestingly enough, this result that this map will increase the value, okay? It's the key moment in one famous permanental inequality. Who can guess? And by the way, permanent is a particular case of a polynomial with non-negative coefficients, multilinear. Okay, so this fact that if you multiply by partial derivative and normalize will increase the value on the simplices, it's actually the key step, the key observation in the Bregman's proof of mean inequality. So just this thing. So you just apply and the groups of variables will be of course the columns and you only keep doubly stochastic, okay? And this is actually quite ironic because the people who were working at IDA at this problem, they were actually interested in this permanent. This is what they did as a hobby, some of them. They wanted to prove Bregman and they wanted to prove van der Waarden. And they actually had the tool, but so, yes, okay. Yes, yes, yeah, yeah. So for minimization, you need concavity. This is kind of strange. For have effective scaling, for minimization, you need concavity. And for maximization, which is hard problem, you need, okay. Okay, so now with all this done, we move to hard stuff. So remember, I am almost done. So the hard stuff was this. So again, you have a polynomial. And you would like to ask bunch of those questions which we all discussed here, okay? How to check whether given monomial is in the support of polynomial. How to check whether given rational vector is in the Newton polytop of polynomial.
You should say that the polynomial is given by a formula, not explicit.
Yeah, as an oracle, black box, okay, yes. And the funny thing is in that Markov, hidden Markov model, it was exactly the situation that polynomial is a likelihood function. So you can compute it using essentially product of matrices, but it's like exponential many, okay. It's so beautifully how this practical stuff actually, okay. So those questions. Again, given black box, which computes evaluating oracle, to check whether given thing is, or Newton polytop, okay. But the most importantly for the computations, I wanted to have bound. For instance, like this. We can do it for any monomials, but for instance, this bound. And actually, let me be very arrogant, like this. And moreover, sometimes I want P. And again, it's kind of absolutely, it's not true in general. Just take this polynomial like this one. Sum of powers and divide by n. Capacity is 1, mixed term is 0, okay. So. And now I said capacities. Now I will give you another capacity. So this is not true. Now we need to get to complex numbers. And so what I will do, I will take polynomial. I will plug in complex numbers. We'll take absolute value. We'll divide by product of real parts. and take infimum over real parts are positive. Let's call it like complex capacity. Mm-hmm. And this is like the leap. You need complex numbers. And of course, this thing is less or equal than than standard capacity. And I assume coefficients are non-negative, okay? So here's the cool thing. In general, there it could be like this, okay, obviously. But if I know that this guy is positive, then they're equal. So again, if I know that this thing is positive, the complex capacity is equal real capacity. But if this guy is zero, I gave example, that's okay. And moreover, actually computing this guy is hard and computing that guy is kind of easy, okay? Okay, and now this is true without any, I don't need to even give you any definitions. This is like the pure analytic theorem. I define this C capacity on complex numbers, okay? But again, this is kind of to shorter the presentation. But really, again, if this guy is zero, then of course it's nothing to prove, okay? So the hard part if this guy is not zero. But this guy is not zero means that implies that my polynomial does not have roots with positive real parts. Because otherwise it would be zero. And this is that notion which I called H stability. And it's again related to hyperbolic polynomials. So and that thing it works. And moreover, it works in a very by the way, now it's blossomed. And for instance, some young guys like Nishit, one of them, and there are a group of people at Stanford. It just blossomed. Okay, and the one of the coolest applications of this essentially the idea of the proof that by induction by partial differentiation was used in the Cardison Singer, and they explicitly said that was motivated. Okay, so anyways, but here is interesting kind of historical comment. It's all started with this question. Okay, and for this, and now we're going back to whole thing which I started with. So this would be the natural condition, necessary condition for the guy to be in support. And the natural condition is, I take a subset. And it's supposed to be less than degree because degree is the maximum. Yes. Okay. And that's supposed to be true for all subsets. Okay. And that was rather daring things, which I conjectured that if you have those polynomials, that for them this is necessary and sufficient. And the reason was, there was many reasons like that Lux conjecture, but the reason was that this polynomial is like quintessential example, determinantal polynomial with positive semi-definite matrices. Of course, non-trivial such that sum of those positive definite matrices is strictly positive definite. And for this polynomial, it's easy to prove. And again, It's Rado theorem, but then it's easy, okay? And here's the interesting situation. You see, all the talks here, even though they're abstract, but they all were like matrix-based, okay? So you really stay in that realm of matrices, okay? You really use that basis structure. Okay, so the reason why Cartesian-Singer was so successfully solved, and the reason why so many generation of really smart analysts failed to do it, is that their proof did the following. It started with matrices, or this rank one vectors, okay? But the first step of induction, they leave that realm. They go to polynomials, okay? There are no matrices, okay? So there are, okay, people worked real hard in function analysis to have a matrix or operator proof. The trick was to go from matrices, and this is exactly what I did. I don't have time to elaborate on this stuff. Okay. So to make, and this thing led to this operator questions. So with operator question, it was actually quite funny. So if you look at that, so I gave a talk here at the Institute of Advanced Study in 1999. And actually I told about my solution of that's Bapat conjecture here and about other things. And then the title of the talk is Operator Scaling. So it was 1999. So actually, I gave a talk at another thing, 19 years ago, there was another beautiful workshop, but on matrix scaling at Rutgers. So this, our workshop is actually, it's a successor, okay? And unfortunately, not all people who took part in that workshop are still alive. But anyway, so here is the new generation. I talked about operator scaling there. But I really started interested in thing when I went to Los Alamos, and I realized that what I wanted to do does not work in general case, but works in rank one case. And I started to ask people about rank one. They say, oh, this is separability, entanglement. Oh, I'm in business now, like funding, grants, you know, like. So now, okay. But the interesting thing is that what was cool about that 2004 paper or 2003 paper, I think it was one of the first papers on quantum information which did not use physics terminology at all. There were no cat notation, you know. And people were so angry at me, but now they more or less followed that kind of structure, that kind of language which I was used here. So anyways, so that what I mentioned, that permanent or positive semi-definite matrices, which is, I think, is the coolest result. And this is actually the result for which, I can get booms. But anyway, because it has dramatic implications. I don't want to elaborate on that. Approximating permanent of positive semi-definite matrices. But of course you would like to do it better. But anyway, so that has a dramatic applications. But that thing does not follow all those neither scaling nor hyperbolic stuff. It required completely different machinery. The proof of van der Waarden was actually simpler, but it required different machinery. So anyway, so there are different scalings which are related to some strange semi-definite relaxations, okay? And actually, because I don't have time, so that paper, the first paper which I mentioned, 2002, which has the title Quantum Matching Theory. So what is matching theory? Actually, there was an attempt to introduce something actual matching in the quantum setting. So when it's like not points connected to sets like bipartite graph, it's vector connected to linear subspaces. And to have some kind of selectors. So it's related to that Adam stuff, which actually Roy was talking about. And the counterexamples actually, it's very similar to this, that, you know, you cannot comb that. But that thing kind of pushed aside because I will tell you honestly, especially to young people, it's so much more fun dealing with actual inequalities than with algebraic geometry. But anyway.